Now I have the honor to present one of my dear friends. He's a doctor from Kuwait. He's the consultant of and the head of endocrine and diabetes department, Jabir Al Ahmed Hospital in Kuwait. And Tamer Al Isa is also one of the board members of the Tasman Hospital. He's one of the head of the examiners of the diabetes board in Kuwait. Tamer is going to talk about recent updates in type 2 diabetes management, the composite program. The MSD has a beautiful program called the composite program, including insulin, metformin, and chronic kidney disease. Let's wait and see what Dr. Tamer is going to say. Welcome, Tamer.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you for the MSD for the kind invitation. Thank you all for your kind arrangements and attending for this lecture. I wish I was there with you guys, but hopefully we can send the information as we intended. My role today is to talk about the composite program, and it's a program that was designed to look at some of the parts of the efficacy and safety of using sitagliptin. Now, I'm going to talk about the main components of the composite program, which is the composite R study, the composite I study, and the composite M study. The first trial, which is the composite M study, which was done to look at a specific question, and it's probably one of the most important things that we deal on a daily basis when we manage diabetes, which is looking at the efficacy and safety of sitagliptin therapy in patients who are inadequately controlled on submaximal dose of metformin alone. So we would want to see from this trial to see is whether adding sitagliptin or only increasing the dose of metformin would have any different impact on diabetes control. So the way that this trial was done was having patients who were not on oral therapy yet or been on metformin-only therapy with a dose of about 1,000 milligrams once a day. These patients, where all of them were started on or switched to immediate-release metformin with 1,000 milligram daily, so sub-maximal dose, meaning below the maximum or another full dose of metformin. And they were kept on this dose for about 6 to 10 weeks. If they're not within control, so if they had an A1C between 7.5% to 11%, then these patients were randomized into this trial. So the randomization was increasing only metformin to 1,000 milligrams twice a day, or increasing metformin, but also adding sitagliptin 100 milligram once a day. And with this, we wanted to see the effect on A1C reduction and diabetes control. So the primary outcome was looking at A1C reduction with this randomization. So what happened is that what's expected is that patients who are increased their metformin to maximal dose plus adding sitagliptin had a better A1C reduction compared to patients only had an increase in the metformin to the maximum dose and given a placebo. So there is 1.1% reduction with the combination versus 0.7% reduction with only up titration of metformin. The difference, you might say, that it's only 0.4%, and you can judge that this is a very minimal effect on A1C, but this showed a significant superiority. What's also important is that you can actually achieve this more reduction of A1C with no significant change or difference in the incidence of adverse events. So this is the table looking at the adverse events between patients had an up titration of metformin plus the sitagliptin versus only up titration of metformin with the placebo. And there was no difference between any of those of the known adverse events, including hypoglycemia. So this means you can get a better reduction of A1C with no excess risk of developing a complication or adverse event. So in patients, in the summary of this trial, that the patients with type 2 diabetes who are inadequately controlled on only 1,000 milligrams a day of metformin, early initiation of sitagliptin with increasing the dose of metformin to 2,000 milligrams per day had a greater reduction of A1C and had a comparable safety and tolerability profiles. The second trial is the composite R study, and this is done on a special group of patients who had mild renal impairment. So the question was here, if you have a patient with a mild renal impairment and had uncontrolled diabetes still, Do you add cytagliptin or you add dabifenglucan? Now, keep in mind, the composite R study was not designed to look for renal protection or any cardiovascular protection, but mainly to look at A1C and diabetes control. So the trial was designed so that adult patients who had a mild renal impairment with estimated GFR between 60 to 90, but had uncontrolled diabetes with A1C between 7 to 9.5%. And they were either on a maximal dose of metformin or even a maximal dose of metformin plus a sulfonylurea. These patients had a screening period and placebo running period, and they were looking at the GFR. If they were between the range of 60 to 90 and uncontrolled diabetes, then they were enrolled in this trial. When they had enrolled this trial, half of these patients were given cytagliptin 100 milligram. The other half of patients given dabigatran started as a 5 milligram once daily and then up titrated to the full dose of 10 milligram once daily at week 4. And the vast majority, more than 93% of these patients actually ended up using the full dose, which is the standard therapy for dabigatran with a 10 milligram. So what happened to these patients? So these patients actually, when they were given cytagliptin, they had a better reduction in A1C of about 0.5% compared to patients who had dabifenglucan added to the combination therapy, where they have an A1C reduction of 0.36%. Now, definitely you can appreciate that the difference between them is very, very minimal, which is only 0.15% difference between those two groups. But it was statistically significant. That's what actually statistics would show. But what's more interesting to me, to at least, is that looking at the population who had a proportion of them having an A1C of less than 7%. And this is what it shows here, that patients receiving cytagliptin, about 42% of them had an A1C of the target less than 7% compared to only 27% of patients on dabigatran. Now, you can have a further explanation about this, whether the renal impairment has had an effect on that or not. Possible, and we've seen trials that patients who develop mild renal impairment or declining eGFR might have a loss of the ability of A1C reduction with SGLT2s in general. But don't also be very clear is that with dabigatran, just like all other SGLT2s, you would appreciate there is a much loss of weight, and that's what happens with the SGLT2, and also further decline in the systolic blood pressure. And that's also very obvious that we can see in patients receiving SGLT2s. In terms of adverse events, there was no much excess or difference in the adverse events between those two groups, especially in the hypoglycemia. But also you can appreciate, and this has also been seen in other SGLT2s, there is an increased risk of developing urinary tract infections in patients receiving dabigatran compared to cytagliptin. And even in patients looking at the events of developing genital mycotic infections, whether they are in females or in males, the risk of having them in dabigatran patients, like other SGLT2s, is elevated or higher than patients receiving cytagliptin. So in this trial, the composite R trial, in participants with type 2 diabetes who had a mild renal impairment between GFR between 60 to 90 with inadequate control of glycemia plus diet and exercise, metformin alone or in combination with sulfonylurea, what it showed in this trial that treatment with cytagliptin for about 24 weeks resulted in a greater reduction in A1C relative to the treatment with dabigatran, and the treatment with cytagliptin and the treatment of dabigatran for 24 weeks were generally well tolerated, except for the known symptoms or the side effects that comes with the SGLT2 regarding the urinary tract infection and the genital infection. The third trial I want to present is the composite I study. And this is also a very familiar situation in daily practice because it involves patients who are initiated insulin basal therapy. So these patients are the big group of patients where they are on initially when they're enrolled, so they could either be patients on DBP4, any type of DBP4 with metformin, or a DBP4 with metformin plus a sulfonylurea, or only patients receiving metformin plus a sulfonylurea. So this group of patients, if they had uncontrolled diabetes of an A1C between 7.5 to 10%, all of them were switched to giving them cytagliptin and discontinuing all the other therapies except metformin. So all these patients, whether they are on all other types of DPP-4s, all sulfonylureas, all of them were put on sitagliptin and metformin, and all the other therapies were stopped. And they were continued for about 48 weeks, which is the week run-in period. And if they did not have a controlled A1C, which is not within the target range, so they had an A1C of more than 7.5 to 11%, then these patients had an initiated insulin glargine to try to control their diabetes. And these patients then, after the initiation of the glargine, they were enrolled in two arms of this study. The first arm was leaving sitagliptin on, meaning continuing sitagliptin, even though these patients had initiated insulin glargine. The other group were discontinued sitagliptin. So they initiated insulin and then the sitagliptin was discontinued. And they were giving a placebo matching the sitagliptin in the active arm. And then these patients had a titration of insulin glargine to fasting plasma glucose within the target, which we'll mention in the next slide. So this is basically how the study was done. Giving all patients sitagliptin, kept the metformin, initiated insulin basal therapy, and then switching these patients or continuing sitagliptin or switching into discontinued or the placebo. And we wanted to see in this trial whether keeping sitagliptin would have any further benefit in the control of type 2 diabetes. So this is the algorithm that they used for titration of basal insulin. The target was actually very strict. They wanted to reach a fasting glucose of a 4 to 5.6 millimoles. And so they would increase the dose of glargine by 2 units. If the fasting plasma glucose is more than 5.6, they will increase by 4 units if it's more than 7.8, and they will start declining or decreasing by 4 units if they develop hypoglycemia. So what happened to these patients? So these patients, uncontrolled type 2 diabetics, started on insulin therapy. If the sitagliptin was continued and not stopped, these patients would have a better A1C reduction, about 1.8%, compared to patients started on insulin therapy, basal, but stopped sitagliptin, which their A1C reduction reached to 1.4. The difference, very similar to the first trial we mentioned, is about 0.46, so almost 0.5% reduction. So also minimal reduction, but it was statistically significant, meaning you would have a better A1C reduction if you continue sitagliptin and not stop it. The other thing is that it's important to mention here is that the dose of insulin. So patients, if they continued on sitagliptin, they had an average of about 8 units less compared to patients who sitagliptin was stopped, which had slightly higher total daily dose or insulin dose of basal insulin. So this is also very important because you could save on a daily basis 8 units of basal insulin. And that translates at the end of the month, and you can multiply 8 units by 30 days, and then you can do that for 6 months or a year. So you can actually limit the amount of insulin being used in these patients. Also, looking at the fasting plasma glucose, then this is in milligrams, you can actually appreciate that patients, if they kept on sitagliptin, they had also a lower fasting plasma glucose compared to patients with sitagliptin was switched to placebo. Also very minimal, there's only about 6.5 milligrams difference, but it was statistically significant mentioning that. With that also, the percentage of patients reaching the goal of less than 7%, it was actually more. So patient kept on sitagliptin, about slightly more than half of them, 54% of them, had actually a successful A1C reduction of less than 7% compared to patients who are switched to placebo, so only about 35%. And this is, I think, the most important part of the study is that you can have more patients, like more stuff about half of your patients with an A1C of less than 7% compared to about a third of your patients. In terms of side effects, there was no significant difference in the adverse events, whether you keep sitagliptin or you stop it and you switch them to placebo. Even the hypoglycemia, the episodes of hypoglycemia, whether it was symptomatic hypoglycemia, severe hypoglycemia, or even asymptomatic measured hypoglycemia, there was no difference between the groups of sitagliptin versus placebo. So the addition or the keeping sitagliptin did not really increase the risk of patient developing any adverse events, including hypoglycemia. So in summary of this last trial is that after 30 weeks, in the participants with type 2 diabetes and inadequate glycemic control and metformin and sitagliptin, when initiating and intensively titrating basal insulin, glargine in this example, continuing sitagliptin compared to discontinuing it have helped to greater reduce A1C from baseline and also fasting plasma glucose, and had a better or greater percentage of participants reaching an A1C of less than 7%, had a lower daily insulin dose, and had a very similar overall tolerability and the incidence of hypoglycemia. So with that, I conclude my talk. Thank you so much for your attention, and I'm happy to answer questions later.